Welcome to the Genealogy Gems Podcast, providing quick and innovative ways to make the absolute most out of your research time and creative ideas for sharing and displaying your family history. I'm your host, Lisa Louise Cook. Welcome to episode 44 of the Genealogy Gems Podcast. I am so glad to get back to the microphone after being sick this last week. There were a few days there where I didn't have a voice at all, but now it's back pretty much, and I am raring to go. So thanks for taking the time to join me today to discuss our favorite topic, genealogy. We're going to cover a lot of stuff today, but there are always items that we just don't end up getting to on the show each week. So to be sure that you don't miss a thing, be sure to sign in for the free monthly newsletter. Just go to genealogygems.tv and click the newsletter button and then send me an email with your name, your state or country, and how you first heard about the podcast. The newsletter is where you're also going to find out what's coming up on future episodes and where I make announcements first, so you won't want to miss receiving that. And let's see here. What was going on before I ended up sick and sneezing and coughing and, you know, being a complete nuisance to everyone around me? Last week, my youngest daughter came home with an unusual extra credit project for her biology class. She said that her teacher had given them a poem and said that they were supposed to create a pedigree chart depicting the relationships in the poem. Well, as soon as I read it, I recognized this poem as a song that I had heard before. And perhaps you have too, but in case you haven't, here it is.
Many, many years ago, when I was 23, I was married to a widow who was pretty as can be. This widow had a grown-up daughter who had hair of red. My father fell in love with her, and soon they too were wed. This made my dad my son-in-law and really changed my life. Now my daughter was my mother, 'cause she was my father's wife. Complicate the matter, even though it brought me joy, I soon became the father of a bouncing baby boy. My little baby then became a brother-in-law to Dad, and so became my uncle, though it made me very sad. For if he were my uncle, then that also made him brother of the widow's grown-up daughter, who was, of course, my stepmother. Father's wife then had a son who kept them on the run, and he became my grandchild, for he was my daughter's son. My wife is now my mother's mother, and it makes me blue, because although she is my wife, she's my grandmother too. Now, if my wife is my grandmother, then I'm her grandchild. Yeah, and every time I think of it, that nearly drives me wild. 'Cause now I have become the strangest case you ever saw. As husband of my grandmother, I am my own grandpa. Oh, I'm my own grandpa.
Isn't that a riot? It's called I'm My Own Grandpa. And let me tell you, this was one of those times when my kid was glad to have her mom's help with her schoolwork. Well, we got her done. So we somehow made a chart of all the relationships that they talk about in that song. Anyway, kind of a strange thing, but glad I could be of help to my daughter. Glad to know that my genealogy background is proving to be helpful. So there you go. And let's see, last week I also played host at my house to my local genealogical society, the board, which I'm on. And that's always a great incentive to do an extra thorough house cleaning, which after a long winter was well overdue, I'm sure. And it was my friend's birthday to boot that day, so I took the opportunity to create another family history themed cake. Now, you may have seen the 50th birthday cake I created for a friend of our family's of his family farm on the blog recently, the Genealogy Gems news blog. Well, I love cake decorating, and I think I've mentioned to you that my mom is quite artistic in a variety of mediums, and we used to always tease her about all the artwork, you know, that was strewn around our house when we were growing up. So cakes seemed like a great medium to me because they're a creative outlet. And they get eaten, which means they're not all over your house forever. So I took up cake decorating when I was pregnant with my first child many years ago, and I still enjoy doing it today. So for my friend Sandy, for her birthday, I made a round pink fondant cake with sort of a Wedgwood icing detail and black ancestor silhouettes that were all around the sides of the cake. And you know me, I love silhouettes, and I have discussed their history in past episodes. Well, they're ideal for cakes because all you have to do is cut out the outline, and you don't have to worry about decorating all the facial features. So it was a lot of fun, and I'll include a photo of the cake in the show notes for this episode so you can see what a family history-themed birthday cake looks like. And of course, you can always get the episode show notes by going to genealogygems.tv. and clicking the podcast button and just follow the links. And I've recently posted a photo album of many of the cakes that I've done in the past on my Facebook page. So if you're interested in cake decorating, you can check those out. And again, I'll have a link to my Facebook page in the show notes as well. Facebook is free and it's easy to set up an account and you can restrict who goes on it and that kind of thing. But it's a lot of fun. We have a lot of fun over there. And speaking of Facebook, I suppose I could have blamed listeners Liz and Leslie for delaying my podcast this week, if I wasn't actually sick, which I was, because they have me hooked on playing a game called Scramble with them online. Scramble, it's totally addictive, and you get this large kind of Rubik's Cube board looking game board on the screen, and there's a letter in each box, and you have to make as many words as you can in 3 minutes, and it's amazing I get anything done anymore because it's so addictive and it's so much fun. So I admit it, I've been wasting a little bit of time, but actually it kept me kind of busy while I was sick. But anyway, not to waste any more time, let's get to the mailbox. Several of you wrote in to say that you identified with the email that I read last week from Michelle Goodrum, who told us about how she found the location of her ancestor's homestead in Colorado. Well, Roxanne Diakow Moos, I think I'm saying her name right. I hope that's right, Roxanne. Roxanne's played Scramble with me on Facebook. Roxanne wrote in to say that she visited an aunt and uncle in Saskatchewan, Canada, and that they took her to visit the old homesteads of two sets of great-grandparents. Now, you may be thinking that it might not be worth tracking your ancestors' home locations down because, you know, they might be long gone, but Roxanne found that it was still very rewarding to go. She writes, "In both cases, the house is gone and someone else owns the land, but to walk on it was amazing. Part of me felt like we might be trespassing, but then I really didn't care because this was where my family lived. It was indescribable at the time. For me, what was most meaningful was to see my uncle walking ahead of me and pointing out where his grandparents' house was positioned, and I snapped a picture of him at that moment walking on the land, knowing that when he was a young lad, he would have been there running around on that homestead and maybe even in that same spot that we were standing. It really is an incredible feeling." To others who look at my family history album and see the pictures, they see a picture of land with nothing on it but a field. But to me, I can picture an old building that used to be there that raised a family and can almost picture the kids, my grandmother and her siblings, running and playing. Well, thank you, Roxanne, for sharing that. There is really a special connection that happens when we make the journey to our ancestors' home. And you really described it very well. And on my list of future travels actually is definitely Saskatchewan, Canada. Now, you all know by now that my husband's grandfather and great-grandfather settled in Regina, Saskatchewan after leaving England in 1912. Well, Raymond Cook did such a marvelous job describing Regina, and I won't be satisfied until I see it up close and personal. So I may be in your neck of the woods. And I hope that you all have enjoyed learning about Tyler McNiven's journey to find his father's birthplace in Japan. That was in the March 4th Genealogy Gems news blog. Now, after accomplishing that, Tyler and his friend BJ went on just to happen to win season 9 of the Amazing Race TV show. It's a pretty incredible story, and I'll have a link to that blog article in the show notes so that you can read about Tyler's journey as well as watch his movie of that journey free online. It's really inspirational. And if you have kids, teenagers, whatever in your household, bring them along and have them watch it with you. They will love it. Well, we've got an interesting array of gems today. First, we're going to talk about Canadian border crossings with Catherine Lake Hogan. Catherine Lake Hogan is a native of Windsor, Ontario, Canada, and she's a graduate of the University of Windsor and St. Clair College. She's currently pursuing her professional learning certificate in genealogical studies in English and Canadian research with the National Institute of Genealogical Studies. And she also serves as the webmaster and newsletter editor for the Essex County branch of the Ontario Genealogical Society. And she is the branch genealogist for the Bicentennial Branch of the United Empire Loyalists Association of Canada. Catherine is a lecturer and a teacher, and I met up with her recently at the Family History Expo in Utah, where she talked to me about Canadian border crossings into the United States. Here's the interview.
I'm here talking with Catherine Lake Hogan, who's a speaker here at the Family History Expo. And Catherine, you and I were just chatting about some fascinating records that not everybody, I think, hears about in their daily research, but that could be a real goldmine. Maybe you could tell us more about those.
They're called border crossing records. And a lot of people don't realize when their ancestors came to the United States or to Canada, that they really didn't come in through the port that they thought they did. So even though you may not find your ancestor in Ellis Island, what may have happened is your ancestor got a cheaper passage to come into Canada first, and then they came into the United States. So one of the resources that you might need to look at are what are called border crossing records. And many of the border towns or cities along the United States-Canadian border kept records. Now, most of those records don't start until the 20th century. Prior to then, the records weren't really kept. You may not find your ancestors in those records as well. And the reason I say that, coming from the border town of Windsor, Ontario myself, is a lot of times people would sneak across the border. And back in the 1920s and the 1930s, especially during Prohibition times, the Detroit River would freeze over and you could drive your car across the Detroit River. Yes, and things aren't like they are today. They're not as strict. They were certainly weren't as strict back then. But if you do happen to find a border crossing record for your ancestor, the amount of information that can be gleaned from that record is very interesting. Generally, you will find on those records are the person's full name. You'll generally find their age, maybe a birth date. You're gonna find out about their marital status. Generally, you will find their address from where they are currently residing, and then they might also have on there where they're originally from, and it might give you more detail than just the country. It might be that city or town that you're looking for. Also, some of the records also ask for a physical description of the person, which is very interesting, because then you get to know what color was your ancestor's eyes and what color was his hair and did he have a distinctive scar on his body, that type of thing. And then, of course, there was a purpose. What was the purpose for the person crossing over? And sometimes you'll find, I know with the Detroit Windsor crossing records, my husband's grandfather, we found a record for him, and he was going to go visit his aunt. in Detroit, and it gives her full name and address as well.
Wonderful.
Yes, and then they ask, you know, how much money are you bringing over with you? You know, how long do you plan to stay? And that type of thing. So it does get quite interesting. And I also found some records of some people that were rejected coming into Canada as well. This was in 1910, and it was in British Columbia. And it was a miner. He was coming into Canada, and he was rejected because he had no money. He came with no money. And then along with him were two ladies of the evening. Yes, they were sisters.
Stated profession?
Or? They said, no, it stated right on the record, prostitute.
Oh,
it stated right on the record, prostitute. And although they had money, if I believe correctly, one was carrying $100 and one was carrying $50, which was quite a lot of money back in 1910.
Yeah.
They were not allowed to come into Canada. And I think it had to do with their profession. And I think the Canadian officials probably thought, you know, we've got enough of our own, thanks, don't need any more.
Oh, that's wild. So what were some of the crossing locations from Canada to America? What would be some of the crossing towns or, locations?
Okay. Some of the most popular ones are St. Albans, Vermont, into Quebec. And, of course, Windsor and Detroit is a very popular one. Then you have, I'm trying to remember them all.
Anything near Wisconsin?
Wisconsin, yeah. So Wisconsin into Saskatchewan. Then there was Alberta. And you have that coming down into, I can't remember my states now, Idaho and Nevada. And then, of course, Washington State and British Columbia. Now, one thing that I do recommend people doing is getting a map. Because that helps tremendously to see where the border crossing towns and cities are, because some of them are so tiny, you wouldn't know they would even exist. And I give an example is one from Sombra, Ontario, the teeny weeny little town of Sombra, Ontario, and Marine City, Michigan. And there's a ferry that runs back and forth between Sombra and Marine City.
Wow.
Yes, and it's tiny, and it's one of the easiest border crossings to get across. But you didn't hear that from me.
Right.
But it's just one of those tiny ones, and you actually have to look on a map to actually see that it's a border crossing. So that's a little bit of information that you're going to need to kind of know beforehand, is, you know, a little bit of the geography. Where was your ancestor at that time? And then you can kind of pinpoint which border crossing they were most likely to cross through. If your ancestor was coming into the United States and they came in through Halifax, then you're going to look into some of the border crossings into Maine. If they came into Quebec City or Montreal, then you're going to need to look at the border crossings coming into Vermont.
Right.
Yeah.
So once we have a sense of that's a possibility, where can our listeners find the records?
Okay. Some of them are on databases on ancestry.com and ancestry.ca. You kind of have to know both of them, because some of them are on one database and some of the records are on the other one. And you have to do a little bit of digging. They're in some funny places, but they are there. And then some of the records just aren't available on the internet. You would have to go to a repository, such as a public library or the Library and Archives of Canada, to find those records. And you would find them on microfilm.
And it seems, I know I've had some success, it seems like the Archives in Canada is progressing in getting some digitized records online, at least some of the immigration records. I don't know if they're indexed, but I know they're there.
No, most of the time they are not indexed by surname. They're indexed by geographical location. Yeah, so you need to find another surname index and know the location. I was just on the LIC website a couple weeks ago, and some of the information that they have uploaded now is just tremendous. They do have ship passenger records on there now, and I don't know if they have any of the actual land border crossing records. They may have. That's one website you need to keep checking back on a regular basis, because they do keep adding things a lot.
Well, fabulous. I'm glad I asked. Thank you so much for sharing. This is a good little gem that people are going to be able to go take a look for. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa.
Well, as you probably have gathered by now, I'm quite a fan of the Library of Congress, and I recently came across a little gem that I want to pass along to you. It's a downloadable digital preservation cheat sheet. The library is working to stay on the forefront of digital preservation, and they are passing along their know-how to us with this really convenient little cheat sheet. It covers computer files, finding digital materials, digital photos, email, and storage disks. Now, each category, they offer up some quick background and challenges to preserving these materials, and then quick tips on the best way to proceed to preserve them. It's a colorful sheet that you can post on your wall to coach you along on the best ways to preserve digital materials, as well as a very good reminder to back up your files often, which we should all be doing. This is so important to us as family historians because more and more of our materials are coming in digital forms. Isn't that true? I know in my case, I've received many, many emails from researchers and distant cousins around the world that I don't want to lose. And certainly many of the copies of precious photographs that have come to me have been in digital form attached to emails. And then there's always those census records and other digital documents that we're downloading from various genealogy websites. So there's a good chance that by now the majority of our information is in a digital form rather than in tangible hard copy. So a good place to start to test your digital preservation know-how is by taking a little quiz that I mentioned a couple of months ago in the Genealogy Gems monthly newsletter, and that you'll find it on the Library of Congress digital preservation website. And you'll learn some more important information about preservation along the way as you take the quiz. In fact, there's a lot of good information at their website, which you will find at digitalpreservation.gov. And I'll have a full website address that will take you straight to the page where you can print out the cheat sheet and where you can take the quiz. And I'll have all of that in today's show notes. You know, there's no time like the present to get started preserving our digital materials. Well, coming up next is my interview with Richard Black of the Godfrey Memorial Library, a wonderful library devoted to genealogy in Middletown, Connecticut. Richard Black retired from a career as a developer of insurance computer systems and is currently the director of the Godfrey Memorial Library. He's been active in genealogical research for over 50 years, and he specializes in online genealogical resources and has a deep interest and commitment to genealogy work. Here's my conversation with him.
I'm here with Richard Black from the Godfrey Memorial Library, and welcome, Richard.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
There was a wonderful reception at the banquet last night. I know Godfrey Library sponsored it, and I know a lot of our listeners are familiar, or at least have heard the name Godfrey Library, so I'm here to find out what's new, what's coming up, what is going on through your website. What's new with Godfrey Library?
There's a couple of things that's interesting that are happening. We're starting to put some of our own unique content online. For instance, we have the first church records from Middletown that are all unique. They are all original, and you're seeing those start to show up. We have the funeral records from three major mortuaries that are now starting to show up online. Those are all unique. And we are working with another organization to digitize a lot of the family histories that we have within the library. So on the website, you'll start to see a lot of unique new content that is not available anywhere else.
So you're really taking on the digitization project. Is this digitization of these records, or is it more of an indexing?
It's actually digitization. They are not indexed, but they're in there by year, usually. So if you're looking for the year, you can then search down through those records and see them. These are all handwritten records, and the handwriting usually is very beautiful. You know, the handwriting back then was really a lot better than we do today. At some future point, we will actually start indexing those. But right now, they're available, and you can search them. And they're becoming more and more available.
Great. And we'll back up for a second. For the occasional listener who maybe hasn't heard of Godfrey Library, tell us about where you're located and what you focus on.
Godfrey Memorial Library is a genealogical library, and that's all we do. It is not a lending library. It's a research library. We have volumes there that go back, some volumes, 200 years old. Now, many of them are 100 years or very old, so obviously we can't lend them out. The library has about 120,000 items in it, Now, many of those are books. We also have what's called vertical files, maps, biographies, and those kind of things that people have given us or lent to us to put in the library itself. We are in the process of merging with an organization called the Indian and Colonial Research Center out of Old Mystic, and that material will start showing up also on our site before long. The Indian and Colonial Research Center is a small organization that focuses mostly on Native American material, and that will quadruple our Native American holdings.
Wow, that's an exciting area that it's probably a little more difficult to find good research information.
Yes, it is. This organization was called by a woman started by a woman by the name of Eva Butler, and we're excited about the merger of that organization with ours.
And tell us, where is the library located?
Library is located in Middletown, Connecticut. That's about 15 miles south of Hartford, in the middle of the state. We're a nonprofit. We do not receive any municipal funding. So we are reliant upon those that would donate or, you know, otherwise help us fund that. Our online offerings obviously help with that funding.
I think they were talking a little bit last night about membership. How can somebody utilize or be part of the library?
Well, we have, first you can come into the library if you're in the area. For many people that's a ways. But you can also order subscriptions to various online offerings. Our basic offering, which has thousands of links, is $35 a year. We then offer additional access to companies like newspaperarchive.com, which is a large set of newspapers. And we also have a joint marketing agreement with Vital Records, World Vital Records. So there's other options that you can purchase in order to get access online. You can also go into godfrey.org and sign in as a guest and see a lot of material free.
Oh, okay. So there's some things to get acquainted with and see if it's touching on the areas that people are researching. That's great. And I'm curious, what do you think of the Family History Expo? And are you guys a regular fixture here? This is my first time.
I think this is either the third or fourth year we've been here in a row. I know it's the third year for me, and I think that former director was here the year before. This next year, we will focus on more and more of these expos, and we'll start attending more and more of them. So you'll see us in many of the conferences and expos.
Terrific. Well, thank you so much for taking time to talk with us today.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.
Profile America, Tuesday, March 11th. One of the most devastating public health crises of modern times hit the U.S. on this day 90 years ago, and experts are still studying it, hoping to head off a similar global pandemic. The first cases were reported among soldiers at Fort Riley, Kansas, just back from fighting in Europe. Called the Spanish influenza, the virus moved quickly, and in October, the worst month, 195,000 Americans perished. By 1920, nearly one in four Americans had suffered from this strain of the flu, killing a half million of them. Worldwide, some 22 million people died. Even less dramatic forms of the disease are deadly. Each year, nearly 60,000 Americans die of the flu and pneumonia. You can find these and more facts about America from the U.S. Census Bureau on the web at census.gov.
That was Profiles of America from the U.S. Census Bureau. And I'm pleased to announce that the new Census History website that Bill Morey, Chief of History Staff at the U.S. Census Bureau, told us about in the Genealogy Gems podcast episode 43. It is up and running, and I've blogged about it on the Genealogy Gems news blog on March 10th. Now, the new website address is census.gov/history, and then there's a slash at the end. I'll have a link for you in the show notes, but be sure and check it out. I think it is very interesting. And Bill was very interested in getting our feedback on what we think of the website and maybe the kinds of information that you'd like to see featured on the website. So if you send me an email with your comments at genealogygemspodcast@gmail.com, I will get those directly into Bill's personal email box. And he said he was looking forward to hearing from all of us. So it's nice to be able to have a voice in what's being provided out there. And I tell you, it was really nice to have the Genealogy Gems news blog to stay in touch with all of you guys while I was sick and I didn't have a voice. So I certainly couldn't produce the podcast. And on the blog this month, or the last couple of weeks, you'll find a tribute blog article to March being the Women's History Month. And there's the hot off the press news that the popular British TV series, Who Do You Think You Are?, where they research the family trees of celebrities, is actually being developed now for American audiences by NBC. So to read these articles, just go to genealogygems.tv and click the blog button, and you can scroll down to view the various articles, the most recent ones at the top, and then they work their way backwards from there. So there's always something going on in the world of genealogy, even if I don't have a voice this week. And with that, we have come to the close of another episode of the Genealogy Gems podcast. You can find us on the web at genealogygems.tv, and I certainly encourage you to spend some time this week exploring the website. New things are being added almost daily now, and I've got a great new movie recommendation for you, and lots of new genealogy videos, as well as the free monthly newsletter. And of course, there's always my book, Genealogy Gems, Ultimate Research Strategies from Season 1. The book has everything covered in it that was in the first 20 episodes and lots more, including photos, websites, and lots of extra step-by-step how-to information. So that's available in paperback and actually now as well in digital download from the website. And of course, I love hearing from you on all topics. So drop me a line at genealogygemspodcast@gmail.com. Let me know what you're up to, how your research is going, what you like on the show, what you want to hear about. All those good things. And of course, you can always find that email address on the website on the contact page. So don't worry about writing it down if you're driving or anything. Thanks for listening and have a wonderful week. I'll talk to you soon.